You left so quick last time, I didn't get to say hello. How are you?
Thank you.
How's it going?
It's going well.
Do we know anything yet?
Not yet.
Getting close.
Yeah.
For one blowout on your side, usually.
Well, Lester was a little shaky for a while. I mean, he gave up three straight hits. Of course, they told him pregame, stay out of the middle of the zone. What was he doing? Everything was middle zone.
He's sporting his tie tonight, I see.
Yeah, he's supporting his team.
Your tie.
All right. It is 7 o'clock, and it's time to get started. This is the Farragut Board of Mayor and Alderman meeting for October 24th. Before we start, I want to introduce Dr. John Avant, who is the new senior pastor at
Concord.
Concord.
Baptist Church.
When you get my age, you get these things, you know.
Senior moment.
We'll start by rising for the invocation to be given by John Avant, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Can you go to the podium there?
Let's pray together. Lord, as a new resident of this town, I want to just personally thank you for the privilege of living here. Lord, you've brought our family to a place that's quickly become home. And Lord, we love this town, and we desire the very best for this town. And so, Lord, I thank you so much for leaders, for good men and women, Lord, who are here to lead today. And Lord, I ask for your wisdom and your blessing on each one of them. And Lord, we recognize we're in troubled days. Lord, it doesn't take much to know that, to see that, to see, Lord, that our nation is struggling, and we're in trouble in so many different ways. But Lord, I'm not a pessimist. I'll never be a pessimist, because Lord, I know who has the end of this story, and I've read the last page. And I want to thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in our world today. I want to thank you that we can join you in what you're doing, and that the greatest things you've ever done, I believe, are just ahead as we seek you to move in powerful ways in every part of our community, our state, our nation. Father, we ask for nothing less than a mighty move of your Spirit in this nation. And Father, that's always tended to start with one person somewhere. Start with me, Lord. Start with us. Do something in us, in our community, that can make a difference in this world. Lord, help us to live, to really live before we die. Thank you for the privilege of living this life and for this evening together. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. David is going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
For the born and unborn.
Thank you. Thank you, John. First item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda.
I would like to just ask a question out of courtesy to the many people that are here tonight, and I'm not sure if they're all here to approve the Calhoun's New Year's Day run or not, but guessing they aren't. Do we want to consider flip-flopping the agenda, reversing items 6 and 7?
There's no reason we can't, is there?
However the board likes to, I think we'll get through those items fairly quickly. I don't know if anybody's here for any of those items. Is anybody here in the public for those items?
Mm-mm.
So that would be no problem.
All right. What do you think? Anybody in favor of changing?
We think it'll be quick. That's fine. I'm just raised the question. I didn't know what else was on there, so if anybody else had spoken, but that's fine.
Well, going into item 7 is going to be pretty quick.
Okay. That's fine.
So shall we approve it?
I'll move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. This is the time for the mayor's report, and I have, again, a pleasant chore. And this is going to be in the form of a proclamation, which I will read, and then we will present the proclamation. Whereas the Teacher of the Year Award not only recognizes some of the best teachers in the state, but also provides an opportunity to learn from their inspired, effective methods of instruction. And whereas on October 3rd, 2013, Wanda Napier Lacey, an advanced placement calculus teacher at Farragut High School, is a 30-year veteran educator who was inspired to teach because of her parents did not have the opportunity to earn a college education, was named as the 2013-14 Teacher of the Year by the Tennessee Department of Education. And whereas Ms. Lacey is a lead teacher at her school and also assists with in-service trainings, most recently on the numeracy for the Common Core, her community involvement is also significant. She integrates ways to assist the Love Kitchen and the Second Harvest Food Bank into her classes. And whereas Ms. Lacey founded the Farragut High Math Academy, where she works with students and their mentors from the community organizations such as ORNL, Alcoa Aluminum, and the University of Tennessee to further inspire students who are interested in pursuing careers in mathematics and engineering, science, and technology. And whereas during her 6 years as AP Calculus teacher at Farragut High, every one of Lacey's students has taken the AP Calculus exam and 97% have earned college credit. And whereas Lacey's teaching philosophy centers on high expectations for every student and maximizing the student's individual mathematic ability, now therefore I, Ralph McGill, mayor of the town of Farragut, do hereby proclaim Friday, October 25th, 2013, as Wanda Lacey Day in the town of Farragut. Hope you're here.
And she also has some guests in the back that have joined us.
Congratulations, dear.
You want to say something?
Oh. Makes me cry.
Honorable Mayor, Vice Mayor, Alderman, what an honor it is to come before you and speak. And I can't tell you how thankful that I am that you bestowed this on Ms. Lacey. We are so blessed at Farragut High School to have such quality teachers, outstanding teachers, outstanding students, and a community that is dedicated to academic excellence. You know, I think back to, you know, Mrs. Lacey and her career. 30 years of dedication to a labor of love. 30 years of demanding excellence. She's a teacher of students, a teacher of teachers, and a teacher of administrators. She's dedicated to a cause. And a minute ago, you heard the good Reverend talk about the future. Our future sets on that hill with those students. What a treasure you have in Wanda Lacey and the staff of Farragut High School. She represents all those and the educators across Tennessee that are dedicated to making sure that our students become those leaders that are not afraid to step forward, not afraid to ask why, and not afraid to excel. Thank you, Wanda Lacey. Thank you for your dedication, and what a treasure. And thank you.
Oh.
You know, this is just the latest in a series of accolades that are being earned every year in the schools in this town. And I hope we never get used to it, but keep them coming. Now, I do have a story to tell. My daughter was always allergic to math, and she would break out in hives just at the thought of the word math. And in the earlier years, she sought help from me, and it always ended up with her crying.
You were
been there.
But she was in your class 22 years ago. Yes, Kimberly. And she made an A, and it was still a struggle. And but in the process, you became her favorite teacher. She made an A, and she went on. She went on to be valedictorian. She wouldn't have been that had she not made that A. So she remembers you. I hope you remember her. Okay.
Great story, Mayor. Great.
So thank you all for being here for that. It's really an honor for her as well as the town. So we appreciate it. Now we got to get on with business. Where's my...
I think that's yours right there.
That's the 10th.
Here, use mine.
Citizens. Where'd it go?
She got you.
I'll find it for you.
All right. So this is the time for the Citizens Forum, and I guess we do have some people signed up, right?
I think everyone has signed up for the ordinance, the reading of the parks.
Okay, ordinance. So no others?
Mm-mm.
Okay, we'll come back to that. Next item then is approval of minutes from October 10th, 2013.
I'll move for approval.
I'll second it.
All in favor say aye. Aye.
I'm abstaining because I wasn't present.
So we move to business items. First one is approval of Calhoun's New Year's Day 5K.
Yes, sir. This item involves a request for approval for a special event application related to the Calhoun's New Year's Day 5K fun run to be held along the portions of Parkside Drive on New Year's morning. Over the past few years, this run has been held on Neyland Drive at the Calhouns there. The running event is sponsored by the Knoxville Trap Club. As shown in the race information packet, the event will start and end at the Calhouns parking lot on Parkside Drive. The event will feature a loop along the portions of Parkside Drive. There'll be some short-term road/lane closures within the affected portions of Parkside Drive. Setup was to begin at 6 a.m. and clean up by 11 a.m. The Calhouns parking lot will be used at the staging facilities, including the restrooms. Traffic control from parking areas and along the route itself will be addressed with the Knox County and City of Knoxville Police Departments. EMS personnel from Rural Metro will also be on hand. and all the volunteers will have the event cleaned up by the time of closing. Staff recommends approval, provided the representatives from the affected subdivisions be notified of the event ahead of time. The staff would also recommend the sponsors ensure that upon the event's conclusion, their entire race course is free of litter. Motion is to approve the Calhoun's New Year's Day 5K run with the road closures along Parkside Drive on January 1st, 2014 from 6 a.m. to 11 a.m.
Is this what used to be on Thanksgiving?
No, this is a different one. This is the Calhoun's evidently used to be, this New Year's Day run used to be down on Neyland Drive, and they've moved it out west this year. But the Turkey Trot is the one we approved the last meeting, and it's still on Thanksgiving morning.
All right.
I'll move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Next item is approval for request for supplement to for engineering services, Everett Road improvements.
Yes, this item is a supplement request from Robert Campbell and Associates for additional fees associated with the Everett Road improvements project. Back in 2007, the town entered into an agreement with Robert Campbell and Associates for design of roadway improvements on Everett Road from Union Road to Smith Road. Ah, that's a good overhead there. At that time, we had an agreement with the original developers of what was then Everett Hills Subdivision. They were to design and construct improvements on Everett Road from their subdivision entrance south to Smith Road, and the town was going to, we had our own project to extend those improvements from Smith Road down to Union. It was two separate projects, and that was 2007. Now, the improvements that are called for here are two 12-foot lanes with curb and gutter, sidewalk, and greenway. Since that time, of course, the economy has happened. The original development stalled, and the project has basically been put on the back burner, more or less shelved until such time that became a bigger priority. At this time now, we have moved it forward with as Split Rail Farm is now coming online. They have taken over that development, and we have a new arrangement with this developer in that the town will go ahead and construct all of the improvements as one project rather than it being two separate projects. Back in about 2008, just as things were stalled, the two sets of roadway plans, they were probably about 95% complete at that time. So our job here is to combine the two sets of plans, complete everything, bring it up to current standards, and then let it as one project. So I've had two or three conversations with Robert Campbell about this, about how to combine everything, and it's a fairly daunting task. It's a little more difficult than just taking two sets of plans and stapling them together. That would be nice, but we can't work it that way. So they have requested a supplement that would increase their fees by $16,470. That would bring their total contract to $92,373.66. I've actually got quite a bit of experience in cutting up plans and moving, doing a portion of plans or combining plans, and I fully agree that this is a very good price for us, and staff recommends approval.
Daryl, I have a question. Daryl, have we moved this ahead of Union Road?
I believe that's correct, yes. I mean, we have been purchasing right-of-way on this. We've not been moving quickly on it. It's not been a major priority, but since we'd already made offers and purchased a lot of the right-of-way, we've continued whenever a property owner would come to us and say, well, you made me an offer a couple of years ago, and I think we can go ahead and close on it. So we have moved forward on it.
Because I thought, wasn't Union Road on our capital improvement plan for this year?
Actually, Alderman, when we met earlier this year, because of the development of Split Rail Farm, I think the board voted to move the CIP, move this project ahead of Union Road. So that's why it's in here at this time.
Okay. Thanks for refreshing me on that. I knew we had Union Road on there.
I'll move for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Next item then is approval of agreement between the town of Farragut and KALU LLC to continue the use of town of Farragut commuter parking lot on Campbell Station Road.
Thank you, Mayor. The town and KALU LLC entered into an original agreement in November of 2009 to the town lease spaces from that entity at our commuter parking lot off of Campbell Lakes Drive, at the corner of Campbell Lakes Drive and Campbell Station Road. And at that time, we had roughly 55 parking spaces total, 27 of those leased from that entity. In February of this year, however, the CAT bus route stopped from that location. So the number of users has also dropped dramatically since that time. As we've continued looking at the usage of the parking lot, we've noticed that there's been an average of around 25 users still utilizing the park and ride lot. That can get as high as in the low 30s, maybe as low as the upper teens, depending on what day it is. And as we looked at how many spaces we had on our side of that parking lot, we realized we probably were going to need a few extra spaces in order to accommodate a maximum of approximately 33 cars total. So we talked to the ownership of KALU LLC and came up with this agreement that we're proposing to the board tonight. We would lease 13 parking spaces from them. We'll continue to mow the areas that we were already mowing at the facility. We'll also reconfigure and designate the new spaces from where the old spaces were. There is some movement of spaces around. And for that, we'll pay a yearly contract of $3,000 paid quarterly to them for that approval. So the agreement tonight is to approve the First Amendment and amended and restated Declaration of Covenants and Restrictions, grant of temporary and permanent easements, and agreement with KALU LLC regarding the commuter parking lot on Campbell Station Road.
David, with CAT being gone, who are these folks that are using the lot? Do we know what they're affiliated with? Are they just sharing car rides, or do we know anything about any organized efforts?
I think there is some car ride share, but I think also TVA is still utilizing that for their van carpools that they do to the various facilities in town. So we do know that TVA is still utilizing that parking lot.
We're not getting any support from them at all towards this parking lot?
We have not asked them for any support. At one time, they did move off-site when we were really struggling for the number of parking spaces that we had. Since CAT left, then we told them they could reutilize the parking lot. And so that's why our usage has still been around, 25 to 30. I think, again, if we asked TVA to move, if they were willing to, then we probably would see that usage drop again.
Are you using like half the lot, do you think, or do you have a feel for what they're doing?
I think when we looked at it maybe last year, they were utilizing at least probably 10 to 15 spaces, just depending on the day and who all was going to be there.
So does anybody see any downside to this?
No, I applaud the town staff for, we're going to reduce our cost from 17 to 3, and there's good reason for that. I'm not 100% convinced we need it at all, but I'm willing to go with it at least for the next year and take a look at it, again in the future. But I think with what we have today, I'm I can live with it. So with that said, I'll make a motion for approval.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, so now we move to ordinance, first reading, ordinance 13-23, an ordinance to amend the text of the Code of Ordinances of the Town of Farragut, Tennessee by amending Title 20, Chapter 1, Section 20-101-2, allowing firearms to be carried in municipal parks and recreational facilities by those persons authorized by the state of Tennessee according to Tennessee Code annotated section 39-17-13-11.
Mayor and Board, in September 26, 2013, we held a workshop to talk about this issue and get the board's feedback on how we needed to proceed. And just to recap a little bit about what we discussed about a month ago now, our current park regulations do not allow firearms in any of our parks or greenways or parking lots in our park facilities. In fact, our town code specifically states that firearms and fireworks shall be prohibited at all times except by authorized personnel, usually meaning law enforcement. They're the only ones allowed to carry in our parks. Back in 2009, the Tennessee State Legislature actually amended their state laws to allow guns in the state parks, and at the same time they also allowed them in municipal parks unless municipalities wanted to not allow them in their parks. We already had an existing ordinance dating back to 1985, so the board at that time elected to continue the ban on guns in our parks for anybody other than law enforcement personnel. The board's obviously been contacted recently by individuals to look at re-looking at that ordinance and our current provisions regarding that. We have done some internal things regarding a survey that we did with our park users to get their feedback, and that's in your packet for your review. We've also asked the sheriff's office to give us the crime data for the parks over the last 5 or 6 years. That's also in your packet in case you need that to review. And we also included a report of many of the cities, not all, but many of the cities in Tennessee that have either chosen to allow guns in their parks or not allow them in their parks. We have attached and prepared the current ordinance, which would allow for guns to be utilized in the parks by personnel authorized by Tennessee Code Annotated Section 39-17-13-11-B. And the exact wording of the amendment to the section I read earlier in our ordinance would then read, firearms and fireworks shall be prohibited at all times except when possessed by authorized personnel pursuant to Tennessee Code Annotated, Section 39-17-1311-B. With that, I will be happy to answer. Well, excuse me, I just wanted to say one other thing. The Parks and Athletics Council did meet on October 1st to review this, and they voted 9-0 to recommend denial of this ordinance going before you tonight. And with that, I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
I'm not sure who's on that council, but did they give any reason for this?
I think as the parks, our chairman of the parks committee is here. You may want to ask him for their discussion and analysis of that.
Yes, I'd be interested to hear that.
Yeah, the committee met the first of the month. There are 9 people on the committee, and I might add some of us are gun owners. There were 3 things that we did discuss at length. The first thing was the report from the police department concerning the issues that have transpired there over the last 5 to 8 years. And from what we understand, only one assault was made, and it was, I believe, by a teenager late at night. And I think that was the only assault that was on the list.
I don't mean to interrupt, but I read that report, and I thought there was at least one report in all but one of our parks over that period of time.
Do you happen to have that, David?
Yes, sir, I do. There was one simple assault in 2006 at Mayor Bob Leonard Park. There was one simple assault at Campbell Station Park in 2011, and there was one aggravated assault at McPhee Park in 2013.
Okay. I stand corrected.
Okay. Interesting.
But we did discuss how safe our parks are, and that was a concern of ours, being, of course, the Parks and Athletics Committee. The other issues stem around so many children in our parks and young children. And I guess the concern is, if guns are present, it would increase the risk of an accident happening, and trying to avoid that by not allowing guns in the park. And then the third issue has to do with the fact that the town of Farragut, we're very proud of our parks. We've got some of the best parks in the state, and we want to continue to draw people to our community, and we're hoping that we can draw people to our parks for competitive athletics. And what we have learned was that the TSSAA apparently do ask questions about whether or not guns are permitted and allowed in the venues in which they use, and we thought that might be detrimental to us bringing in sporting events and bringing more people into our community. So after the discussion, we voted, and it was unanimous, 9 in favor of continuing with the ban. Any other questions?
I had one just about the committee and its interaction with, are you a group that meets in a back room and shuffles paper? Do you actually get out in front of the representatives of these users of our parks and meet with them and interact with them? And if so, what's the scope that you feel the committee has? Is it a good representative sampling of our community?
I believe it is. Now, we meet, of course, whenever we're trying to decide who's going to use the fields, we meet with those people. Now, we have not discussed with them an issue, but we do, I believe, have a good representation of the community at these meetings. And, of course, Jay Smelzer also meets with all these people that use our parks, and we get feedback from him as well. So we also, there was a survey done. David, I don't know if you have that information, but I believe over 50%, 55% or plus were surveyed as to not wanting guns allowed in our parks.
Of course, that's in a place where guns are banned, so you wouldn't have people who would support it there, you would think.
Well, there were people there that supported.
Yeah, 45% in spite of the ban.
55% said no.
About with the town of Farragut residents, I thought that was kind of intriguing. And again, these are actual park users. This is not some theoretical exercise. These are not people in the Kroger's parking lot. They're actually using the park. And so, refresh my memory, as I recall, there was a larger percentage of among the Farragut residents that were in this survey.
Right. It's interesting. We didn't ask, or at least I don't know if it was in a report, whether or not the people that were in favor of guns were Farragut residents or outsiders visiting our parks. So I don't know how to answer that question.
Okay. We were presented with a statistic, and I'll just show you. It said it was 64% of those that were identified as Farragut residents were in favor of keeping things as they were, whereas it was 55% overall.
Overall.
So that was a figure that was shared with us. So, And I was curious, too, about the survey sampling. I don't know if yourself or Sue could answer that about, you know, the methodology for it. Was it, days picked at random? Just out of curiosity, how the survey was arrived at.
I had nothing to do with that survey, Sue.
That's why I was kind of looking in the back of the room.
Alderman Elliott, I could probably answer that. I think we had probably over a 2 or 3 week period at various times of day. We had our personnel go out and ask questions at the various parks. So some were at night, some were during the day. It was random depending on which park it was. We tried to get a pretty even number of users from each park if we could for each one of those areas. So it was over a couple 2 or 3 week period that we went out there.
And again, these were people using the parks?
They were all in the park. Yeah. Yes, sir. They were all in the park.
I have one more question. When y'all were discussing this, did you all consult any type of, statistical evidence? Have there been a lot of accidents with license involving license permit holders in parks anywhere, ever? Do we have some kind of statistic on that that y'all would like to bring forward to support that?
I do not have that. I don't know. Sue, do you have anything? No.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Good.
Thank you.
I did have a couple questions of Captain Palmer regarding the statistics, and I just appreciate some clarification, a couple points. Don't have your cool uni on tonight.
Hi.
You're familiar with the report that we were given, the breakdown the last over the yeah. last 8 years.
Yes.
Of that, by my math, there were 35 incidents on there, and it looks like basically 25 of them were related to vehicular burglaries or vandalism. And I was wondering, how you classify these things when you see a report of 35 incidents, 25 of which are burglaries or vandalism. How do you classify violent, nonviolent? What do you look at it as a professional when you see those numbers and those reports?
I'm not really sure I understand. Just you're going to have property crimes, and then you're going to have crimes against people.
Is that, for a park area, would you expect burglaries? I know I was a neighborhood watch person in our subdivision, and we had a fair share every year of these kinds of things. And I just was curious, is that a kind of a standard thing you'd see at a park as well as in subdivisions?
Are you asking, is that an inordinate amount, or?
Is that percentage about right that you'd see of physical crime against individuals versus somebody taking a target of opportunity with a car or unguarded valuable just laying there?
Well, Farragut, compared to other communities, generally has a lower offending rate. So we are very lucky down here. But you are occasionally going to have property crime like the burglaries and an occasional assault. I think two of those assaults were domestic assaults, and the aggravated assault involved a minor with a firearm.
In your opinion on the 25 of the 35 that were related to vehicular burglaries or vandalism, do you think there would be any significant improvement in that statistic if this ordinance were to pass?
That's a very difficult question to answer. It'd be speculation.
Well, you're a professional. I'm just curious what your take would be on that, if you feel
it's almost philosophical. I mean, if the official sheriff's office response is that this is an issue that should be decided by the Farragut Municipal Board, and we will support whatever you all vote on. As far as the speculating, I don't really think that it's appropriate for me to speculate one way or the other, based on just so many variables. But that's just it's a community issue, and it's something for you guys to, of course, decide for yourselves, and the sheriff's office will support whatever decision you make.
You don't think, again, it's not logical that you would keep the same ratio, or we just feel like, it seems like every year it's kind of a breakdown, looks like about the same ratio every year. I was just curious if that trend, you see that continuing, is that pretty much an average what we're going to expect from here on out?
Difficult to forecast the future. I don't know. I mean, we're going to obviously extend every effort to prevent even what has happened in the future, but there are no guarantees in life, but we'll do whatever we can to fight crime and to hopefully prevent even the small numbers that's happened, the relatively small numbers comparable to other communities.
Thank you.
And just one other thing I would like to mention is these are reported offenses. These are documented incidents that has happened. whenever we actually file an official report.
I've got a question for you, Captain Palmer. You said there was one incident in the park that involved a firearm, and that was a minor, right? Is that correct?
Yes.
So that would not be a licensed permit holder, because minors are not allowed to have
permits. No, that's right.
So we can be pretty sure that as long as we maintain the ban, the only people who will have guns in the park will be unauthorized, or in fact, a criminal element.
Well, Alderman, that's a supposition that you can make. Again, the official sheriff's office response is that whatever you guys decide, we will support.
Thank you.
Do we have some citizens?
Yes, sir. Our first speaker is Stephen Kissinger.
Mayor, Vice Mayor, Alderman, before I begin, I need to make a quick disclaimer. I am an attorney with Federal Defender Services of Eastern Tennessee.
With who? I'm sorry.
Federal Defender Services of Eastern Tennessee. I've practiced basically nothing but constitutional law for basically the last 20 years. The reason I mention that is because I have to make it clear that I do not appear here in any way, shape, or form on behalf of Federal Defender Services of Eastern Tennessee, and my opinions in no way reflect the opinions of my boss or anyone else there. I appear here today solely because I'm a resident of Farragut. I live in Fort West, and just came to speak about this issue. I may know something about the Constitution, I may know something about crime, but I'm not here to give legal opinions, I'm not here to talk on behalf of my employer. Just so that's clear, let me go ahead and start. excuse me. One of the things I noticed in the materials that have been circulated, not just here but in other places, is that when we look at the statistics at the park, the rate of crime is exceptionally low. The rate of violent crime is very, very low. So low that I think it would be difficult to justify this change in ordinance on the basis of need. That there is a need that that people in the parks are in danger and have a need to go armed in order to protect themselves. Now, I don't think that that necessarily ends the discussion, because I think there's a legitimate point to be made that there are people, particularly people who've gone to the trouble to get training, to get a concealed carry permit, that people want to make a statement, that they want to make a statement that not just about the training they've overgone, but a statement about their rights under the Second Amendment, things like that. And I think that's a legitimate consideration. I think it's somewhat, you know, I think arrogant may be too strong of a word, but it's a little arrogant to say, well, you know, if all you got for it is that you want to show everybody you got a gun, that ain't much of a reason. I'm going, no, it is a reason. Those are legitimate reasons, and I don't think we should belittle those. On the other hand, I think that, like any decision that a board like this makes, it needs to be a weighing of things. What is the cost? What is the benefit? Now, agreeing that that's a benefit, and putting that on one side, that it gives people an opportunity to demonstrate, to exercise their rights, in a public place to demonstrate their feelings on this issue. Giving that weight, I think we have to look at what's on the other side. The other side, and I don't think the other side is just that public opinion is against it. I think that's a valid consideration, though. If the public's against it, if we're a representative body, I think that's a significant factor. But one of the things that concerned me most of all is that when I look at communities, and I look at communities all around the state, in connection with my work. And when I look at a community, the kind of things I look for are not just like crime rates, but what's the community's perception of the crime problem? So we have a situation here where our parks are not safe, yet when we pass ordinances like that, people look at, like this ordinance or the amended ordinance like that, they look at these kind of statements and say, well, hold it. What's the situation in Farragut that they need to allow people to carry guns in parks? Is it not safe in their parks? Are children not safe there? Are women not safe there? And it's something that people think about when they look at this community. And that's something they're going to think about if this ordinance passes. So I think that's one thing on that weighs against it. The other thing, and I hesitate a little bit to bring this up, but I think that if we look at the business reaction across the state to the moves to increase the opportunities to possess firearms, that this move to allow firearms in parks, in other establishments, in parking lots, is seen as an anti-business position.
And
the only reason I say that is because you get an intersection between the employer's rights to control, like their employer, to control their personal, to control property, to control like what their employers do. I know, for example, the reason that I had to stand here and give the little speech before we started is because my employer knows that what I say might reflect on them if I don't make those explanations. My employer knows that they have a right to control what I do outside of the workplace. Now, maybe I don't agree with all the positions, but I follow them. And I think when we get in this situation, this is one of the things we need to take into consideration. I know there's differences of opinion within the business community, but it's one that many businesses, and we see them, and we hear about it all the time. Businesses going, hold it, I can't stop this. Well, this is different because it's a park, but it's the same kind of thing that people go, what kind of environment are we coming into? What kind of environment is my business coming into?
Okay, you're making some pretty interesting statements. Can you name a company that has this perception? Name one?
No, of course not. No, I mean this is just stuff in the media. Are you suggesting that there aren't?
I'm not aware of any.
You're not aware of any business.
In fact, quite the opposite. In Kennesaw, where they passed a law requiring everyone to hold firearms, has experienced explosive business growth since that time. I'm just kind of curious what your basis.
Dollar General, who fires employees for possessing guns. I mean, there's one. And there's a number of companies. Our company doesn't allow employees to possess guns either in parking lots, on the premises at any time. And quite frankly, we have more reason to possess guns than most every business in Farragut. Because oddly enough, some of the people we see aren't as nice as others. So I think that's another thing that needs to be taken into consideration. One of the big justifications, and when we talk about low crime rate, people say, well, hold it a second. Isn't this a situation where you have a high potential for damage from a single incident? Doesn't that justify it? And there comes a point where you're going, now, hold it a second. There's a high potential for damage from any catastrophic event. For example, we could be hit by a meteor. Now, admittedly, you get hit by a meteor less than once every 6 years, but once in every 6 years, which is the one serious criminal offense that we saw in Farragut Parks, is not very frequent. So again, I don't see how we have that kind of justification.
Can you wrap it up?
Okay.
We've got others wanting.
Oh, I'm sorry. The only other thing I wanted to mention was, that may have been our business. And the perception, and that it gives the perception that the community is dangerous when it really isn't, when this is an incredibly safe community. I leave my garage door open. I have a $3,000 bike that sits there in plain sight, and which I probably shouldn't be saying in an open meeting like this, but.
Yeah, where do you live?
But anyway, and I've never worried about crime. I don't think it's a necessary ordinance. I understand that passions are strong on. I'm a gun owner myself. I've got a half dozen weapons sitting in my house right now. And I'm not anti-gun at all. I happen to agree with the Heller decision and those kind of things. It's just that you have to look at these in a practical sense. On a practical sense, there's more downside than there is to an upside.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Who's next?
Bill Masters.
We're going to have to limit it to no more than 5 minutes.
Mayor and Alderman, as you can see, I'm an old gentleman. I've been around 86 years. I've seen a lot. I've worked with a lot of people. I've studied a lot of people, and I think I understand the thinking of many folks. And when I came to Farragut, I've been here for 25 years. And you people, along with others, have built a beautiful park system, something you can really be proud of. And the fact that you're talking about putting people with guns, whether licensed or not, doesn't matter. A gun is made for two reasons, to scare something or kill something. And I'm afraid that if you're going to allow guns in parks, then those folks like myself who are afraid of a gun are not going to go to your parks. And as far as my own personal opinion is concerned, and I am a resident of Farragut, I live off St. John Court, and it's just a matter of fact that I think many people, if you were to put it for a vote, those people who were in favor of guns would be out to vote. Those people who didn't really care wouldn't be there to vote. So a personal vote is not something that carries much weight. But just as an opinion, I'm totally opposed.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Brenda Tyrell.
I'll keep mine very brief. I just wanted to say that I use the parks, I enjoy them, I walk in them, and I feel very, very safe changing the ordinance and knowing that there are concealed weapons on people I might be passing would make me feel less safe. And if there are people that think they do need protection from assaults or animals or something like that, I would suggest stun guns, mace, a stick, something that is not lethal if it's accidentally discharged or someone misfires or aims in the wrong direction. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Maria Danker.
I'm also a member of the Parks and Athletics Council, but I'm here as a private citizen, but I think I could, obviously my opinions on the council are the same as mine as a private individual, and I think I could add a little bit to what Ron has also said about what the council discussed. I'm of course opposed to changing the ordinance to allow guns. I am a handgun carry permit holder. I am a gun owner. I don't think the ordinance should be changed. Another issue, of course, is that our greenways come very close to or travel through some school property. One of the greenways goes right by Farragut Primary School. Another one goes through St. John Newman's property. And the schools have serious concerns about the greenway portions that abut their property or across their property, about those allowing firearms, because obviously firearms are banned on school property at this point. And that would really create a problem for the schools or for the town. You know, do we put the sign up right before the Greenway goes through Farragut Primary? Oh, hey, if you had your gun, you got to turn around, go put it in your car if you want to walk this quarter of a mile further down the road. I don't think that that's a good, that the reasons for changing the ordinance are going to outweigh the security concerns or the legal concerns that the schools have. Besides, the other people that have spoken have put the other reasons much more eloquently than I could. But the other big issue that came up for the council, why we have made the recommendation to the board to not change the ordinance, to leave it the way it is for future park expansion, mostly Greenway expansion. When the town is performing property acquisition to expand the Greenways, property owners have a lot of concerns. They're going to have this big strip of asphalt going through their front or their backyard with all these people using it, and it may be a major concern for some of these people to know that there are weapons on the users of the Greenway that's now running through their front yard. So I think that that could definitely hinder the expansion of the Greenways or parks if we're going to be looking at more property acquisition for a new park that's going to impact, obviously, private property owners. I'm certain, already concerned about crime. They're probably already concerned about noise. They're probably already concerned about litter. And I think that the fact that someone might be carrying a weapon a few feet from their door, a few feet from their grandchild playing around, a few feet from their pets playing around in their yard could be something that tips the balance to them saying, no, you're going to have to come after me, eminent domain, if you want a piece of my property. I'm not going to voluntarily negotiate with you. So I think there are a lot of considerations, the biggest of which should be the survey that was done in the parks, but that the other ones certainly should be considered as well, the school issue and the property acquisition issue for future Greenway expansion.
Thank you. Thank you.
I just have a quick question. Are any of our Greenways actually on school property?
Yes, sir. We've got two, one at the primary school, correct, and also at, as she mentioned, St. John Newman. We have a trail that goes right through the middle of part of their area.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Our next speaker is Tom Rossiel.
Tom Rossiel, 425 Clover Fork Drive. I'm here also to oppose any change in the ordinance, which currently prohibits the guns in parks. I think the members of the Parks and Recreation Committee have pretty much summed up most of my comments, so I won't repeat those. I will mention, though, that since Bob, you mentioned you had not heard of any place where business owners want to prohibit their employees from bringing guns onto.
No, I didn't say that.
Well, that was the impression I got. But no, let me tell you.
Let me clarify what.
Go ahead.
I said, in response to the to Mr. Kissinger's said that businesses perceive towns that have liberal gun laws as being anti-business.
Okay.
Well, so I asked, what business can you name one who has that perception?
Okay. Well, then I will only mention, though, that you probably are aware that the Y-12 weapons facility, as well as Oak Ridge National Laboratory, prohibit all employees from bringing guns to their facilities. That's a fireable offense. I also think that Volkswagen, which are some of the bigger employees in the area, just to point that out.
That's totally not germane to my statement.
Just bringing that up.
Okay.
The other issue is, I think the last speaker mentioned about concerns about people with guns. If you're walking in a park and we have a ban on guns and you see somebody with a gun, that alerts you there's a problem right away. But if you see somebody with a gun and you've changed this ordinance, nobody walks around with a sign on their forehead saying, good guy, bad guy. You don't know what their purpose is. And I think that's why some of the concerns have been expressed by the other speakers, why it makes people nervous. You've lost that sense of certainty when you're in a park as being a safe place. If you see somebody with a gun, is that person supposed to be somebody that you can trust or somebody you can't trust? And I think if you pass this ordinance, that's one of the things that I think a lot of people would be concerned with, besides the fact that a lot of people are just uncomfortable with the idea that you're basically saying the parks really aren't a safe place if you need to carry guns here. So again, I ask you to reject this ordinance and vote no. Thank you.
I just have a question for you, Mr. O'Seal. You said that if you see someone with a gun, it's hard to tell if they're a good guy or a bad guy. What we're talking about is authorizing lawful concealed carry permit holders. These would be concealed weapons. You're not going to see. If you see someone with a gun, they're probably breaking the law. Concealed carry is not, you're not wearing a .45 on your hip. This is concealed carry we're talking about.
Actually, you can certainly say that it's concealed. I was, somebody was, I think, serving some warrant or looking for somebody that perhaps broke the law. He was clearly looking like he was, maybe he was, I don't know if it was out of state or what it was, but he had a gun on, and that's the first thing I noticed. And in my neighborhood, he was walking to somebody's house and looking for somebody, and he had his jacket around him, but it was very obvious that he had a gun. And I assumed he had a carry permit. He looked professional, but I didn't know, but I was alerted to something like that. So I don't know if that constitutes a concealed permit or not. I don't know how well you have to conceal it. But if somebody's carrying a weapon, even if they have a jacket on, you can sometimes still tell, Bob. They're not small items. So they're not little tiny derringers that they're typically going to be carrying with them.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Employer, but I am pretty certain that open carry is permitted in the state of Tennessee. Obviously, it is, of course, suggested and recommended that you do not open carry, but it is permitted if you're a concealed carry permit holder. The permit holder just provides you with the ability under Tennessee state law to possess a weapon on your person, and that doesn't make a distinction whether or not it has to be underneath your jacket or if you're allowed to have it open on a holster on your hip.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Robert Smith.
I'm Robert Smith. I'm a citizen of Farragut. My first concern is that the state of Tennessee already allows and licenses trained users and gun owners to conceal their weapon in a safe and trained manner. And as the attorney from Parks said, Tennessee allows open carry. Obviously, we don't want open carry in our parks because of the presence of children. But I would point out to you that people are concerned about guns around schools. On the news yesterday, there was an accident publicized nationwide that during a safety demonstration, a peace officer discharged his weapon in a school. So having ordinances like this to protect school environments is great. Having an ordinance that prevents trained citizens to carry concealed weapons allows self-defense, which is guaranteed in this document. My concern is, whenever you make a gun-free environment, you make a soft, attractive target to people who would do harm to others that are not or don't have the opportunity to defend themselves and must wait for people like the police captain for a 10 or 12 minute response time. I can tell you firsthand from many years in combat that people don't bring a knife to a gunfight. Do you have any questions for me?
I had one. You mentioned a comment about the crime statistics. We've had relatively few violent crimes, what you would classify. Most of them are burglaries, break-ins kinds of things. I mean, are you anticipating or expecting that there would be a dramatic change in these?
No, we don't carry concealed weapons because we expect to be attacked We carry concealed weapons to ensure that we can defend ourselves when our life or property is threatened. A concealed carry permit is a defensive measure guaranteed under the state constitution. And it's duly licensed by the state, and those licenses are only issued to people who are well trained.
So are you seeing that with our statistics? Is there a need for that?
There is, if you'll forgive me, we don't have guns because we're afraid. If that were the case, then everybody would have a gun because we're all afraid. Or we would all have police officers stationed on our block. The whole purpose of the Second Amendment in our Constitution and in state law is to permit citizens to protect themselves wherever they may be. And whenever you ban citizens to protect themselves, then you're at the mercy of whoever wants to do you harm. It's all well and good for you all to sit here because there's a little sign that says nobody can come in here with a gun except somebody who might want to do somebody harm here. The people who carry guns to hurt people are the people that we carry guns to protect ourselves and our property from. I think that you've already violated my rights under the Constitution with the existing ordinance. I do not pose a threat to society by owning or being a licensed carrier of a gun as long as I abide by local rules. Some establishments don't allow me to go in carrying a gun. Other establishments welcome gun carriers. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Our final speaker is Thomas Knapp.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing me to speak. I'm Thomas Knapp. I live in Sweetbriar. It's interesting to hear some of the people who are interested in not having the ordinance overturned. They speak as if a firearm is a live, venomous snake that people with permits carry and it could escape and harm someone. That is clearly not the case. Or that if we are allowed to carry a firearm in the park, that we're going to be playing with the gun or handling the gun. I mean, most people, even though in Tennessee you are allowed to carry openly, most people carry concealed just because it's there for defensive purposes and they don't want to draw attention to themselves. Regarding the crime rate, there's a gentleman by the name of John Lott who's written a book published several years ago called More Guns, Less Crime. And he's got a statistic in that book that says that handgun permit holders have a lower crime rate than do police officers. Just happens to be an interesting statistic. Self-defense is a natural right, really, regardless of what the Constitution says, our founders included in it because it's a natural right. And the low crime rate that is currently in the park doesn't mean that something in the future won't happen. After all, people do win the lottery. They buy tickets, even though it's a very, very unlikely event they're going to win, and a crime can happen. A gun is just an equalizer in the event that gives you an opportunity to protect yourself. Even a man of my size is in a better position to defend myself if I have a firearm against someone who is a bad person. the unfortunate incident, I believe it was in Nevada a couple of days ago, where a math teacher was shot and killed by a student, the reporter for CBS said that there was 3 minutes between the time the 911 call was made and police officers showed up, at which point it was all over. It was done. I mean, that gentleman who was killed was an Air National Guard officer. He had been a Marine Corps officer, and he was completely defenseless against a kid with a gun. I mean, Captain Palmer and the Sheriff's Department, I appreciate the service they offer, but they're rarely going to be on the spot when someone needs self-defense. There was a cartoon I saw years ago that deals with this. There were two bad guys who were running up to a bank, and they had the typical black mask on, and they get to the bank, and there's a sign outside that says, "No guns allowed." The one bad guy turns to the other and says, "Now what do we do?" Right? I mean, that's the situation we're facing. That sign that I see when I go into the library says no firearms allowed in the park isn't going to stop someone who is interested in committing a crime in the park, even as unlikely as it is. People also talk about children using the park, sporting events, school events, whatever the case may be. The thing to consider is that if there is a permit holder in the park and something happens, that person may be able to come to the aid of children or teachers or supervisors who are in the park while the children are there performing their activities. Thank you for the time to speak, and I would appreciate the ban on guns in the parks being dropped.
Thank you.
I have one more speaker. It's Christy Halsey.
Good evening. I came this evening with no intentions at all of standing before you. I came with my young son, who is a Boy Scout. I am a mother, simple housewife, don't have a job. I take care of my children. But I am a representative of Village Green Subdivision. And I'm also on their board. And I say that because the information that I have being on that board gives me information outside of the parks, but within. We have a park system that runs completely around our system, around our subdivision. I'm aware of the crime in my subdivision. We have a licensed police officer who patrols, and I'm aware of the break-ins. I'm aware of the armed people that come in my subdivision on foot to rob us and to harm us. And I'm aware of that on a monthly basis. And because of that information that I carry and that I know, I am asking that you approve this amendment simply for that basis alone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I'm going to bring up a totally different aspect on this. We just opened in Campbell Station Park what we call a Heritage Trail. It's a system of markers, 11 markers, that chronicle the history of this area from the Indians till today. It's very educational. Very informative, and it's a great asset for the schools to take classes over there and go through the trail. They learn a lot. We're also in the process of building an outdoor classroom, which would highlight water flow, how water flows, and how you can do sustainability, how you can use water in different ways. And it's going to be very educational, and it's a place that will have the status of a park. And I would think that we'd have a lot of school classes go and look at that place. Now, we have an opinion from the Attorney General of Tennessee, and I'm going to quote this verbatim. reading Tennessee Code annotated 39-17-1309 together with Chapter 428 indicates that the legislature intended to allow handgun permit holders to carry their firearms into public parks except onto athletic fields and other recreation areas at the time they're actually being used by the schools. So when a school class or school function is in one of our parks, our playing fields, or anything else, you cannot have guns in the park at that time. Now, this would be a situation where we would have to post the knowledge that schools are going to be there between so and so hours, no guns. We'd be having to take reservations from the schools. We'd have to be putting up signs and all that stuff. And that is a business that I don't think we need to get into. If it's no guns in the parks, then we never have to worry about it. They can go freely to these sites. So that's just a different aspect that you need to be aware of. Any other discussion?
I had just one other question for David. There was a comment made by the chair of the Parks and Recreation Committee about the and this came up at the workshop about the Murfreesboro TSSAA situation. And I know we've invested a lot of money in this board. We've approved as an effort of this board to promote the use of our parks for tournaments, for revenue enhancement for our restaurants and for our hotels. And obviously there's probably not much bigger around than the state high school tournaments for all their sports. And I know it's been in Murfreesboro for a while, but other areas have been attempting to get it. West Tennessee's had Chattanooga, Knoxville. Question, if you could clarify for us, what is the status of that? And if it were to come to Knoxville area, and if we were to have an opportunity, could we, with this ordinance, participate?
I think that over the last 4 or 5 years, obviously the state legislature has changed the law quite a bit when it comes to carry permit holders and being allowed to utilize those permits in various places throughout Tennessee that you'd mentioned. Originally, I think when Murfreesboro first elected not to allow guns in parks, they had a lot of discussions with the TSSAA about that. I think they were concerned that that may trigger TSSAA to want to move their state championship somewhere else, and they elected to do what they did back then. And talking to the TSSAA right now, they are really pretty much noncommittal to us one way or the other about how they would feel about, you know, parks having guns or not having guns and utilizing a facility in that regard. They just know that if they did choose that facility, as the mayor just mentioned, if a school was utilizing it, you could not have guns at the park at that time. So I wish I could answer your question more definitively from that group, but they didn't really give us much information other than they would follow state law and they would require whoever they elected to use their fields to follow state law.
You know, I'm just going to offer my thoughts. This is, first of all, I just think it's sad that we even have to have a discussion on this issue. I'm bothered by that as a whole, regardless of which side of the coin people fall on. You know, I've thought about this a lot, and I've gone back and forth. When, the last meeting, we had a lot of people come up here and a lot of service members. And I want to thank you for your service, and I applaud what you've done. I remember the one gentleman told the story about how, I think it was a camp in Vietnam, if I recall, where they weren't allowed to keep their weapons in the camp, and then they had, you know, they were attacked. And I went, well, that's just plain asinine is the only statement I can think of there. But the reality of it is, you know, you look at this issue, and I have no problem with guns. I have no problem with gun owners. I was over at Gander Mountain today, and, I mean, you go in there, and the whole back of the building is a a massive gun shop. You know, I know this is an issue that for certain individuals is extremely personal. I mean, the gun ownership is very important to them. But this is not about gun ownership. And, you know, if we've reached a time in the town of Farragut, if I heard the last name correctly, hopefully I don't butcher it, Ms. Holsey, the mother of the fine scout, you know, if we've reached a point in our community where we have neighborhoods that are dealing with crimes on a regular basis, this issue, you know, changing the ordinance is not going to solve that. You know, that's a law enforcement issue, other than, you know, they certainly have the right to defend themselves within their own home. To be honest, I can't really find a reason to not vote to change it, because I know Alderman Markley has asked several times, well, let's hear statistics. And I'm not an expert on this issue, but certainly I've never seen a statistic that says gun owners are causing all kinds of problems in a community, whether the people can see the gun or it's underneath their jacket, what have you. It has been proven over and over and over that they are a very responsible group of citizens. And I have no doubt that would be the same within our own community. As I look at this, to me it really comes down to how will changing this ordinance that is currently on the books in some way, shape, or form make the town of Farragut a better place? And I don't have an answer for that. I've not been given an answer for that. I can greatly appreciate the desire of people that have a permit to go out into the parks and walk around and have it on them. I understand all the defense issues that were raised, and I think they're all very valid and certainly real to that particular individual. But when I look at how will changing this make our community better, I don't have an answer to that. I don't see how it will make our community better. Will it make some individuals feel safer? Absolutely. Would it make a neighborhood as a whole feel safer? Perhaps. But this issue is about our community, and I just don't see how change will make our community better. I'm not at a hell no forever on this issue, but I just have not seen any data, any answer, any reason to change this ordinance at this time. Again, if we reach a point where we're dealing with a consistent crime issue in our town, then we as the current leaders of this community have an obligation to look at the various law enforcement options that exist, whether that be through enhancement of what the Sheriff's Department does here, or if we ultimately someday in the future have to go to the great expense, and by the way, it would be a great expense, to add law enforcement. But where we're at today, you know, our first speaker, Mr. Kissinger, you know, he said something that I thought was really spot on. We currently have, we have a perception that this is a very safe community, and that perception is real. When you look at all the data, we're not dealing with issues. Anybody can look at any given instance and say, well, this might have happened, this could have happened, and that's all real. As Captain Palmer said, these are my words, not his, but they're really unanswerable questions. I certainly don't look forward to the day where we would be sitting here as leaders saying, oh my goodness, I wish we would have changed that ordinance because we're dealing with a death in our community that everybody says, well, it could have easily been prevented if we would have changed the ordinance. I hope the day never comes in our town that we have to make a decision based on that reason. I know we're not there today. And again, as I look at this as a community issue, I just have not been able to find a reason why changing this will make the town of Farragut as a whole a better place to be.
More discussion?
Yeah, I can answer Mr. Honkin's question. How will this make the town a better place? It will demonstrate that we respect individuals' God-given, inalienable constitutional rights. That's what it will show. And I think if we're going to wait, the argument I hear is, well, gee, our parks are safe. We don't need to defend ourselves in our parks. What that says to me is, let's wait until some horrendous tragedy occurs in our parks and we have an excuse to allow our neighbors and friends to defend themselves. That's what I'm hearing. That's what the argument is. I would ask if there, you said you don't have any data, you don't have any reason to change it. I would say the only argument I've heard is that people are fearful of guns in the parks. And I would ask, is there anyone here who can tell me one single incident anywhere in the United States, in any park, at any time, where any licensed permit holder committed a gun crime against another neighbor? I would just like to hear that. And if not, then why are we banning this most respectable and law-abiding group of people? Why are we curtailing, minimizing, fragmenting this right? Who do we think we are? Why do we, what gives us the authority to diminish or fragment the rights of our fellow citizens, to tell them, you can't defend yourself in our parks. You can't exercise that right in our parks because I fear that something might happen. And yet 20 years of history of concealed carry law shows that that is not, there is no basis for that. It's an ungrounded, uninformed, superstitious, irrational fear. And I don't like having my rights dictated to me because of someone's ungrounded, irrational, superstitious fear. It is a fundamental right, and we don't have the right to tamper with that. That's the reason I would give you why this town would be a better place if we lift this ban. It makes no sense whatsoever. Knox County has done it with no ill effects. The state of Tennessee has done it. The federal government has done it in its parks. What makes us special? Why? Why are we doing this? What reason can we give not to lift the ban? I'd like to hear one rational, credible reason not to lift this ban. I'm begging for it. I've heard a lot of supposition. Well, somebody might perceive us as this or that. Well, let's just wait until a horrendous crime happens, and then we'll reconsider it. I don't think that's prudent, and I don't think we have the right to do that. And that's my position.
Well, I do want to say I don't think anybody is saying let's wait till there's a reason. As I said earlier, I hope that day never comes. I think the worst time to make a decision on something like this would be we're all sitting here lathered up in emotion and we have a citizen of our community or even a guest in our community for that matter that was shot in one of our parks. I never want this board or any member of this future board to have to make that decision based on that. And I certainly won't argue with what you said because you're correct. There is no statistic. I certainly am not trying to take rights away from people. And, you know, we have, as board members, our planning commission has had to deal with issues much smaller than this. And the argument about rights has come into play with individual property owners up here arguing about building codes that we have, curb cuts that we allow them. And in my opinion, laying gun ownership next to something like that, there is a huge chasm between the two. But nonetheless, we do restrict where somebody could have a curb cut. And I know people might be saying, well, where's the correlation? I think there is a correlation. We have an obligation as leaders of our community to make decisions that are best for the community as a whole. And, you know, there are times as individuals, I know I've had it, where I have voted for the best interest of the community when it was something that on a personal level I didn't always agree with. And in this case, on a personal level, as I said earlier, I would have no trouble with people carrying the licensed gun owners, permit holders having guns in our parks. But I just don't see how this is going to make our community a better place. Now, you've used the argument of, you know, we're taking away someone's constitutional right. I don't see that. We are not saying they can't own guns. We are not saying they can't carry guns. We're not saying they can't defend themselves. We're simply saying in certain parts of our community, they're not allowed to do so. There are many other areas in our community, the schools. There's Knoxville has not, if I'm correct, I don't think Knoxville allows. Their ordinance is the same as ours currently, is it not? So, you know, it's I don't see people vacating Knoxville and moving to the county in droves. You know, maybe sometime in the future this needs to be revisited again. I just have not been given, and I have great respect for where you're at. I really do. I am really not even on the opposite side of the coin. I just don't see a reason to do it at this time.
Well, I would have to agree with Alderman Markley. I personally would feel much safer having children in a park if I knew that there was someone in there, if an incident happened, who was a lawful gun carrier that might be able to help in a situation.
Amen.
I just wanted to say thanks for everyone that attended tonight, and it's been an interesting process. I've certainly had the opportunity to talk by phone and email and in person with folks on both sides, and I think a lesson could be learned for those people up in Washington, D.C., because I wanted to get this on the record that I've been very impressed. The discussions I've had with people that agreed with me or disagreed with me have been very civil, have been very polite, and respectful of the fact that at some point in time, sometimes you just agree to disagree. And I do wanted to get that on the record because I think that's important and it says a lot about our community on a controversial issue like this, that you can have this kind of dialogue without people throwing stuff at you and things like that. So again, I wanted to say that. I certainly take a look at this and I look at this ordinance. It is focused on our parks and greenways. It's not about the Second Amendment. I understand people's frustration with the Supreme Court, with the federal government, but this is about our parks and recreation. The evidence and information presented is clear. We have a minimal criminal record in our parks, a very small amount of personal issues, assaults. Most of it is overwhelmingly targets of convenience, cars break-in, vandalism, that kind of thing. I just can't see, common sense tells me, this is not going to be a safer place. And it's not going to change those statistics by changing this ordinance. Our Parks and Recreation Committee, made up of some really well-meaning folks, and I am biased on that. I was on that committee for several years. These are people who really care about this town that are on that committee. It's not a thankful job to get up here with a bunch of different users of wanting to use the parks, all arguing with each other, and you've only got so much space to go around. It takes a lot of patience. And I do appreciate people that serve on that, because that is a tough job when you're sitting up here facing those folks. The our town staff, the impartial survey, I think, again, it shows the majority of people that use the parks are in favor of our ordinance as it is. And again, the folks that are in Farragut that were identified as such are overwhelmingly in favor of keeping things as they are. Many other municipalities have this in place. And again, for 28 years, this town has had this ordinance on this books, and we've had minimal crime with certainly no spike perceivable in any of the statistics of criminal activity directed toward the person. And I've certainly heard nothing to change my mind in opposing this ordinance this evening. And again, I think it's important to keep the safety of folks that are using our parks and greenways and respecting their rights as well for those that do not want this ordinance.
Just one more thing about the mayor's remark that it would be an inconvenience to respect this right. I just wonder if that freedom is not always convenient. I don't know if that was an argument in favor of keeping the ban, but I don't see much validity to that. I think that's something we can deal with. So I just wanted to address that.
All right, somebody make a motion.
I move that we approve the ordinance allowing licensed permit holders to carry firearms in the town parks.
I'll second it.
Call the roll.
Alderman Elliott.
No.
Alderman Honkin.
No.
Alderman LaMarche.
Yes.
Alderman Markley.
Yes.
Mayor McGill.
No.
The motion fails 3-2.
Next item then, town administrator's report.
Thank you, Mayor. We've got a couple of big things coming up here in the next 2 weeks in town. First of all, tomorrow night from 5 to 7, we have Freaky Friday out at Mayor Bob Leonard Park. Great Halloween event for kids age 12 and under. We ask that people that come bring some canned food as a drive that we're trying to do. And then also, all the kids just need to wear their costumes, and we can have tons of candy to give them. So should be a great night at the park. And also on November 7th is the ribbon cutting for our first ever turf field here in really the East Tennessee area for a public park. So we're looking forward to that again also at Mayor Bob Leonard Park at 6 o'clock that evening on November 7th. So hope to have everybody out there and be a part of that.
Do we kick a ceremonial soccer ball out there? Or?
I think we're going to have a few and plenty of kids out there too. So it should be a great event. Also, I forgot to mention, Mayor, next Tuesday we also have the opening grant ribbon cutting of the Heritage Trail at Campbell Station Park. That ribbon cutting is going to be at 11 o'clock out at Campbell Station Park.
Okay. Attorney's report.
No report tonight.
Okay. In that case, we are adjourned.
World Series calls.